Vray 7. What can we expect from the new update? I've been testing the new version and today I show you the new and updated features. Let's check out what is new in the frame buffer. Now we can use vignette as a separate layer. We can move the whole object as well as adjust its shape by moving the points. We have full control over the result. It's very convenient. We also have some options here that help with getting the desired effect, like the size, feather, or smoothness. But also, we can control the shape and position of the effect from here. We can also control the color if for any reason we would have to do that. Or adjust the visibility of the handles. And of course, as with other layers, we can adjust the strength of the effect. Let's say you want the view to be a bit brighter and less contrasty. Not a problem, as now, you can just use a special mask and apply for a layer. You can see it takes an alpha from the image. We have to invert the mask to get the desired effect though. Here we go, a pretty cool option. We also have two options for stopping renderings. Abort rendering will work like a cancel button in the rendering window, so it will not apply the denoiser to the image. While stop rendering, it will add all post-rendering tasks, such as post effects or image output saving. And finally, the polygon region rendering. I think the option requested for a while. Thanks to this, we have more control over selecting parts to render. We can check how single or multiple objects will look with different materials or settings, for instance. Let's talk about lights now. We have a new light object, the VrayLuminare. We can now import bake lighting data for relight lights fittings in PLW format. I use the ready lamp model with these lights from Chaos Cosmos. I quickly compared the standard lights with the new ones. You can notice that with the same time rendering, the VrayLuminare is more effective, but also there is way less noise. But on the other hand, it looks like they missed some details, like here for instance. Talking about the lights, we have an improved VraySky model, which now supports nautical twilight. Additionally, we have new options in the VraySun, like turbidity and altitude. Turbidity will add haziness to the sky. You can notice how the sky is changing when I change the value. The higher the value, the more hazy the sky is. While with altitude, we sort of shift the sky, and thanks to that, we can get a more blue sky effect. We have new tools in the Chaos Scatter in the Surface Scattering. We can use the pattern to create a scatter. We can upload a custom one or choose one from the list. It may be handy to use them in specific scenarios if you need to have a very specific pattern for distribution instead of random results. We can adjust the distribution either through the count or per square options. Another thing is the option to edit instances. We have brush and eraser. We can adjust the radius size and paint over the existing scatter. It's not super quick and it's a bit laggy. We can also draw with the brush. We can choose to follow scattering rules or not. We can also choose to erase only the brushed instances, which is very handy. On top of that, we can convert this scatter to 3ds Max objects. However, in this case, it will be a very unwise action to take. If you have some shrubs on another hand, it could be potentially needed. Now, Vray supports Gaussian splats. It is a rendering technique that uses images taken from different points to create photorealistic scenes. So basically, it means that we can take photos or record videos around a specific space or object even with the use of iPhone. Upload and process them, for example, with the use of an online tool like Polycam, for example. And we can import it later to 3D software and work with this. In Vray, we can do it now by using Vray Gaussian geometry and importing the file in PLHY format. Profiler is an interesting option if you want to keep an eye on the time spent on calculating shaders and volumes, exporting scenes, compiling geometry and displacement, loading bitmaps, and more. After the render is done, you can find the file in the dedicated folder. When you open it, you can find all the hotspots in your scene and optimize pipelines for even faster rendering. The VrayLuminare has been updated. We have an additional geometry tab where we can manage and tweak geometry objects, including Vray proxy, decals, but also Vray fair and clipper. This way, we can speed up the workflow a lot. Instead of looking for the object and changing them one by one, we can do it all from here. The Vray team also added the include-exclude column. Plus, we can undo changes in the Vray lister by using the Ctrl plus Z shortcut. Vray Scene Converter has been redesigned. Scene and bitmap converters are now in one window. It generally looks different. It's better organized and has new options. We can, for instance, choose simple or full conversion from Corona physical material. We have also other tabs here, including Material Library Processor, TX Bitmap Converter, and Settings at the end. For those of you who make animations, Firefly removal option can be pretty handy. If you have Bucket Image Sampler, you'll find it here, at the bottom. You'll just have to check it. It will try to get rid of these annoying bright pixels from your animation. Also, the Vray GPU supports Caustics now. We can turn it on in the Settings tab. Thanks to the Caustics effect, the rendering can be way more realistic, especially when you have a scene with water like swimming pool shot. Additionally, the rendering to the first pixel is faster, and rendering texture-heavy scenes is more efficient with a new implementation of the out-of-core textures. I would say that this version of Vray is all about making things more efficient, as most of the features and updates focus on speeding up the production process. If you'd like to learn how to create stunning visualizations using Vray and 3ds Max, join our course. You can also stay here on YouTube and watch more of my videos. Bye-bye!